Here. My name is Liza Mundy. I'm the director of the Work Family Program here at the New America Foundation. We are looking forward to being an integral part of the conversation around work-family issues. I feel as though the conversation has really exploded over the past couple of years with books by, obviously by Sheryl Sandberg, with Anne-Marie Slaughter, our new president, with her article and soon to be a book that was in The Atlantic about having it all. I wrote a book a year or so ago about the increasing number of women who are the breadwinners in their households. Bridget Schulte, who's a fellow here, has a book coming out about people feeling overwhelmed in their work and professional lives. So it's I think, a really interesting resurgence of energy and conversation around work-family issues, and we're certainly hoping to be a part of that. Today we are so fortunate that Debora Spar has made time for us in her busy book tour schedule. She is, as I'm sure you know, the president of Barnard College. She was one of the youngest tenured female professors at Harvard Business School, and she is the author of a number of books. Her current book is called Wonder Women: Sex, Power, and the Quest for Perfection. It's a terrific book. I've read it and reread it. And I will say, I was thinking about this, the quest for perfection, this morning as I was trying to get ready and leave the house in time to make sure I was here early to welcome Debora and have everything. And I came downstairs and the kids were already gone to school and my husband had already gone to try to get some exercise before work, and there were breakfast dishes scattered around. And so I was stealing 5 or 10 minutes from my travel schedule to clean up because I didn't want to be judged by the pet sitter who came to walk our dogs as, you know, the woman who has the messy breakfast dishes. And so I was musing on the quest for perfection, which led me to think about long ago when I was doing a profile of Hillary Clinton, and I was interviewing a woman who had known her very well in her college years and thereafter, and I was talking about all that she had achieved in her early life, being a mom and being a lawyer, and I was saying, you know, how did she pull that off? And the woman said, who loved her, said, well, you know, she was an indifferent housekeeper. And I thought, that's it. You know, that's why you end up doing those breakfast dishes before the pet sitter comes, because you're the one who's going to be judged as the indifferent housekeeper, not your husband, of course. So I think there are a lot of reasons why the quest, you know, we feel this need for perfection at home, as you describe it, at home and in work. You talk so, I think, evocatively and provocatively, I think, about feminism, and you write that, you know, that young women have turned their perfectionism on themselves as opposed to turning it on the world. And you say that we privatized feminism and focused on our dreams and our own inevitable frustrations. And I think that's a really provocative idea, that somehow we've, everything that feminism was supposed to achieve, and obviously it has achieved a great deal, but that we have turned it on ourselves and asked so much of ourselves in both our work and professional lives. And I'm hoping that you would just take a few minutes to talk about your thesis and expand on this idea.
Well, thank you, and it's a great pleasure to be here today. I've been a fan of New America since it first began, not that many years ago. And I'm pretty sure I spoke about my last book here when that came out. So I'm just delighted that you're here. I'm delighted that they're taking on work-family issues, because as you mentioned, it's just exploded into popular consciousness, which is sort of odd because the issues are not new. The issues are almost eternal and certainly have been really important for the past 50 years, but they haven't been much in the public conversation until quite recently, when all of a sudden you're kind of everywhere. So it's great that you all are going to be playing a role in this. So I will just talk briefly about sort of where the book came from and what its main themes are. And I know that the best part of these events are always the conversations, so I won't speak for too long, and then we'll chat, and then we'll open it up to any thoughts, comments, criticisms you might have. And I'm delighted to see that we have a wide range of ages in the room, because this really is a book that does look at the evolution of the generations of feminism. And it's a book that tries to speak sort of to the differences between these generations, but also the commonalities. So let me just start briefly by talking a bit about where this book came from. As I say pretty frequently in the book, I wasn't raised a feminist. I was born in 1963, which turns out to be an interesting year, again, just in terms of the chronology, because I was alive during feminism, but I was a kid. And so when all of the exciting things were happening, you know, I was kind of 6 and 7 years old. And one of the things I argue is that struggles that are occurring when you're a kid are not necessarily struggles that you identify with as you get older. Some women did, I think women my age, but I think certainly most of the women I know who did grow up sort of post-feminism kind of took all of the advantages that feminism had handed us, said thank you very much, and kind of moved on with our lives. Because by the time I became sort of politically or socially conscious, which was the late 1970s, pretty much all of the Ivy League was open to women. So if you were a smart, ambitious girl, you could go to Princeton, you could go to Harvard. Columbia was still not open, but everywhere else was open. I found personally, I went to the School of Foreign Service at Georgetown, that they were hungry to have smart women. And if you were a smart woman who was interested in, let's say, Soviet military thought, which is what I was doing at the time, you were kind of propelled forward, arguably faster than the men, because there was a real interest for the first time in getting women in these positions. I went to graduate school. All of the graduate schools were open. Women at this time could go to law school. All of the doors had been open, thanks to feminism. But again, if you're a kid and you just see the doors open, you don't necessarily resonate with the struggle. You just, you know, move on with your life, as I did. And I never really read feminist theory, even though I have a PhD in political science. I never studied feminism. I didn't really want to put myself in what I saw as a box. Meanwhile, and this was something I hadn't really thought about until I started writing this book, I, again, like any kid, you know, grew up sort of buffeted by the cultural images of the moment. And what were the cultural images? The images that were out there in magazines, in television, on radio, in movies, were of strong, powerful, working women who were also usually gorgeous and had kids and sex and great clothes. And it was this incredibly attractive image. And so I talk a lot in the book about this commercial that some of you may remember for Charlie Perfume, which was this very alluring commercial. It was Shelley Hack, the model, who was clearly a working woman in the commercials because she had pantsuits, which were very cool in 1973. And she always had a briefcase sort of, you know, just as if to demonstrate that she was working. And in some of them, she has a child. And it's clear the child is being tended to, but it's not clear by whom or how. And then there's men over there, and they're spraying her with perfume. And it's all, you know, very sexy and glamorous. And, you know, I was a smart girl growing up, but I somehow thought, this is what life looks like when you're an adult. And it wasn't just this one silly commercial. This was the era when the Brady Bunch gave way to Charlie's Angels, and Partridge Family gave way to Maude. You know, the cultural images were all of working women, but working women who did do it all seamlessly and effortlessly. And that was sort of the world I presumed I would move into. And to some extent, I did. You know, I moved right through college, graduate school, into the working world. I actually had my first child before I had my first job, which turns out actually to be a pretty interesting strategy, but we can save that. We can save that for later. And it was really only later in my life that I started to realize that my life as a woman, professional life as a woman, was developing very differently than my male colleagues. And I start the book with a very uncomfortable scene that all of my male friends who read it in draft form said, please do not include. But all of my female friends who read it said, you gotta start with this. And it's this very unglamorous scene of my being in the ladies' restroom at LaGuardia Airport with a breast pump, which is what you have to do if you are a working mother. I had just given birth to my second child 3 weeks ago. I didn't get to have maternity leave at Harvard. I had to do a research project, so I was there in the ladies' room using a breast pump when I had one of those rare light bulb moments, which said to me, gee, this is what having it all is really about, and it's not very glamorous at all. And I use it as the anchor story for the book because I think it does convey, really in a visceral form, what it really means to try to be a working mom these days, aside from all the policy issues and questions we can get into. At a very personal, visceral level, it's just hard. And one of the things I find so interesting is that my book's only been out a week, but already women come up to me from all different kinds of women saying, I got to tell you my breast pump story. Every working mother has a breast pump story, and none of them are pretty. They're just not. And so I had this sort of odd light bulb moment, but then more importantly, again, as I got older and went through my career, I started noticing the women disappearing. So most of the women I had gone to college with who were equally as smart and as ambitious were not in the workplace 10, 20 years after graduating college. Virtually all of the women who had started with me at Harvard Business School did not get tenure. Moved on, and I'm sure you've probably all read the Harvard Business School article that came out in the New York Times. This is a big problem, it hasn't gotten any better. Probably most scarily, I noticed that my female students at Harvard Business School were dropping out of the workforce. And these are women who were super smart, super ambitious, super competitive, every bit as smart as all the men in the room. But 5-10 years after they graduated Harvard Business School, they were no longer in the workforce. Or they had really moved to different kinds of positions. And then what finally sort of compelled me to realize I needed to write a book along these lines was about the 9 millionth time when I had that phone call that I'm sure most women in this room have experienced when somebody said, you know, Deb, I hate to do this. I know you're really busy. I know you have 42 things already on your calendar for Saturday, but we have this panel, committee, convention, event, and we really need a woman. And I have one little piece of the book that I call Slogans for My Tombstone. Because I'm, you know, convinced on my gravestone it will say, if they really need a woman, dot, dot, dot. Because that was the role I had fallen into. I was the woman in the room. I was the woman at the table. I was the woman, if somebody realizes it's going to look bad if we have only men up there, let's get Deb to do it. And I had benefited from being that woman in the room. And I want to be honest in saying that. But it's also a very awkward and unfortunate position to be in all the time, to be the woman in the room. And what it really made me realize was this was a very big problem, that there was only one woman in the room. And so I started playing with a book that at the time I was calling Confessions of a Reluctant Feminist, sort of talking about how I came to realize the virtues and values of feminism way too late in my career. And as the book morphed, I also moved from Harvard Business School to Barnard College and underwent what I keep referring to as a massive hormonal shift. But I really realized, and again, I would love to talk about this and answer questions or hear your thoughts, working in a very male-dominated place was fundamentally different from working in a very female-dominated place. And I don't say that as a normative statement. It's not that the female place was better or worse than the male place, but it sure was different. And working, you know, surrounded by women as I am now is very different from being surrounded by men. And I think one of the things I try to do in the book is to argue that we are now, I think, at a place in history where women in particular, it's harder for men to say this, can put these statements out there and say, maybe women do lead differently than men. Maybe women administer or manage differently than men. So how can we think about valuing women's leadership styles and making sure that we're working them into formerly male-dominated organizations and institutions? Just as much as at Barnard, I've actually gone out of my way to hire men because I wanted to make sure that we were getting that diversity of leadership styles and of management styles. So let me just very quickly review sort of how the book works. And it took me a while to come up with the structure of the book, but it's one that I've become quite fond of. It follows the arc of a woman's life. So it starts with a chapter that tries to put sort of my life and my generation in historical perspective, this generation that sort of came right after feminism. And I talk about the great strides women have made, but also, sadly, the fact that women, if just look at the statistics right now, we've totally plateaued out. We are fully 50% of college students, grad school students, with the exception of business school, where we're still a little bit low, entry-level positions in medicine, science, law, you name it. Once you get to the top levels of any organization, of any sector, women hold between 15 and 20% of the leadership positions. So I refer to this as the 16% ghetto, because the statistic 16% actually shows up with alarming frequency. And if you think about sort of why that is, it's kind of the token one or two women. And then once those seats are filled, sort of people get back to the regular business. So I lay that out in the opening chapter. And then I follow the arc of a woman's life. I talk about girls, how we raise girls, what kinds of expectations, sadly, I think we are still now imposing on girls. And the major argument there, this is the argument essentially of all the chapters, is that sadly, rather than getting rid of the old expectations that feminism really tried to liberate us from, we've actually held on to all the old expectations, so that girls should be sweet and pretty and sparkly and princesses. But we've added to them, and they should play soccer, and be really smart, and start their own NGOs, and take care of their younger brothers, and be sexy, but not too sexy. So rather than actually narrowing the range of expectations, we've exploded them. Then I have a chapter on body image, where I'm sure I don't have to convince anyone in this room of that. Feminism was supposed to make women care less about their looks. That hasn't happened. I would argue to the contrary, that the physical expectations, the bodily expectations that women face are just totally unrealistic. You know, we've reached a point now where even the most beautiful women in the world who appear as fashion models are photoshopped. So literally the women whose images we see are not, they're not real. I mean, they're actually not real. And yet young women and older women are still trying and feel somehow compelled to adhere to these images. And I talk in that chapter, as you can imagine, a fair amount about anorexia, body images, and cosmetic surgery. And in the one of the sad things we've fallen into is that the expectations of female beauty are now no longer confined to sort of, you know, the 18 to 25-year-old age. You're supposed to look 17 until you're 97, so far as I can tell, which comes up later in the book when I get to the chapter on aging. Then there's a chapter on sex, which was very hard to write. It's not usually what college presidents write about. But was fascinating, because again, what I'm arguing is there's great news sort of on the sexual arena that women are no longer held to the same kind of sexual expectations they were. That is, you know, to remain a virgin until married. Women were liberated sexually. They had reproductive freedoms that, you know, have really had massive societal change. But if we look at the current generation, and I always feel hopelessly middle-aged saying this, I think the hookup culture is very damaging for young women, because it's actually created another set of expectations that young women somehow feel that part of being young and female means being promiscuous. It means having relationships with men you're actually not attracted to. And yet somehow these same women fully expect that they will be in love and married by the time they're 35. And I see them wrestling to figure out how you make that shift. You know, how do you go from having sort of anonymous, uncommitted sex to having monogamous sex that is still supposed to remain fabulous throughout your entire life? So it's, again, we've actually ratcheted up the expectations. I talk about marriage, which in some ways I think is the weakest but the most interesting chapter in the book. Why do we still get married? Why do we still get married with these giant white weddings? I mean, the white wedding is a celebration of an economic contract in which the woman was given to another family in exchange for a commodity, and it was a contract in which she gave up her virginity in exchange for financial protection. Why are we still doing this? And why are same-sex couples embracing the white wedding with such fervor? I'm not sure that I fully explain the conundrum, but I think it's a conundrum worth putting out there, because it really doesn't make much sense. And the what I do sort of speculate on is, because marriage has actually gotten harder, you know, in some ways with two parents working, with new social conventions, with living longer, staying happily married for a longer period of time is hard. And so sort of rather than dealing with the difficulties of marriage and the fact that we know the divorce rate in this country is staggeringly high, we sort of fetishize the white wedding and don't deal with the messier parts of the actual marriage. There's a chapter on babies and how our expectations of baby making have actually increased. Both Liza and I, in past lives, wrote books on the fertility industry. Fascinating, fascinating area of both society and the economy. And there's a million things to talk about in that industry, but one of them is now the expectation that, A, you can have a baby whenever you want to, which I think is quite dangerous for young women, because fertility plummets, after about 28, and declines precipitously after 35, and yet women now believe that they can sort of put their careers, sorry, put their families on hold while they're pursuing their careers, and then kind of flick a switch and not only have a baby whenever they want, but also have a perfect baby in terms of, you know, buying sperm, buying eggs, hiring surrogates, not to mention all the things you do to make that child perfect from the moment he or she is conceived. So we're creating massive expectations around pregnancy and birth that, again, just didn't exist 50 years ago. There's a chapter on labor distribution in the household. What Liza was just mentioning, you know, why is it that women are still doing the dishes and not outsourcing that? Why are we feeling guilty when we don't do the dishes? And how the heck can we explain this actual ratcheting up of household expectations? One of the basic arguments of Betty Friedan's crucial work was that women had to be liberated from housework so that they could get on with the real work of the world. Yet pick up any magazine on the stands out there, and we are quietly being seduced by images of perfect kitchens, perfect bathrooms, organic, home-cooked, gluten-free meals. What mother here has not, you know, stayed up way too late on a working night to make the cupcakes for the school bake sale the next day because you're sort of too embarrassed to, you know, send a box of Ringdings instead? We've actually ratcheted up the expectations on the home front, which makes absolutely no sense given the migration of women into the workforce. There is a chapter on the workforce. It's not a huge part of my book, actually, unlike some of the other books. And I talk about clearly the issues women are still facing in the workplace, lack of childcare, and critically, I think, the need to bring men into this conversation. If the way workplaces and corporations deal with women, quote, in women's issues, is to create women's networks and diversity forums and populate them entirely with women, we don't solve the problem. We need to bring men into the conversation. Again, I'm happy to say more about this. I think this is actually a very important part of my argument. And then there's a chapter on aging, which again was fascinating for me to write and to think about, because I am arguing that aging falls harder on women than on men. Aging is no fun for any of us, but because we still live in a society that really thinks of women and pictures women when they're about 22 or 23, it's very hard for professional women to age gracefully in their jobs, particularly in some obvious professions, news broadcasters. Anyone who's in the public eye, you can just see the difference. Men are allowed to age gracefully or not so gracefully, and women really, really aren't. And then we have the demographic issues that most women enter middle age, or particularly sort of the older pieces of middle age, single, that they're either widowed or divorced or had never been married, and face another whole stream of economic issues, which ironically and sadly are often compounded by the fact that these are women who were in the workforce for some period of time. So when they get divorced, and then they dropped out of the workforce, when they get divorced, they don't get a lot of support from their husbands, because the courts perceive them as being capable of earning a living. And so they actually enter, you know, old age with very few financial resources. The book ends, bizarrely perhaps, on an optimistic note, because I think actually most of the problems that we face now, they're not impossible to fix. You know, you look at the Middle East, you look at Syria, and, you know, I think personally I have a tendency to say, oh my gosh, you know, I can't even theorize about how we solve this problem. The problems I've just laid out, they're actually relatively simple to think about how we solve them. There's no magic bullets, but part of it, I think, and it goes to the title of the book, is changing the expectations that women adhere to. And that critically, that does not mean giving up. It doesn't mean opting out. It doesn't mean leaning out. It doesn't mean throwing our hands up in frustration. It just means moving away from perfection as a goal. You rarely, rarely hear men asked whether they have it all, because nobody has it all. Why do we feel that women have to have it all and men just kind of, you know, slump around and do their thing? We need to get more comfortable with women saying, this is what I do and this is what I do less well of. You know, if I'm rushing off to work and I've got a couple of kids and a big job, I'm going to leave the dishes alone. You know, more critically, if I'm working a 60-hour-a-week job, I either need to have my in-laws living with me, a husband who has a more flexible work schedule, or world's best childcare, or I can't work a 60-hour job and have kids. If I want to work a 60-hour-a-week job and I don't like any of the childcare options, I may not want to have children. And that's a perfectly legitimate choice as well, but life is about choices. And the beauty of feminism is that it gave women of my generation a choice. I think the struggle we now face, both my generation and younger, is to say we actually have to make those choices. Because just because you have all of the options out there doesn't mean that you can grab every single one of them. And I think men, perhaps because their transition has not been so dramatic in the past 50 years, more naturally have been making these trade-offs, feeling less guilty when they don't bake the cupcakes for the bake sale the next day. And women need to sort of move towards a more easy relationship with their choices so that they can actually return to the idea of liberation, which is a word that has fallen out of our vocabulary. But the original goal, or one of the original goals of feminism, was to liberate women, to free women. And I would argue that sadly, rather than feeling liberated, many women today feel chained. They feel constrained by their choices. We need to go back and reclaim that liberation. And critically, and I'll end on this point, we need to reclaim the collective action goals of feminism. Feminism was not about allowing women to become perfect. It wasn't, as one of the original feminists said to me, and it's my favorite line, she said, "Honey, we didn't fight so you could have Botox," which is just a brilliant phrase. And somehow their struggles, that generation's struggles for things like affordable childcare, for equal pay, for equal rights, for equal access, for a system that values women on things other than their looks, we need to go back and reclaim those struggles and move farther away from this inward focus that I fear has really captured so many women today. So let me stop there, and we can talk, and we can talk, and
I'll ask questions for a while, and then we'll open it up to questions. One of the many pleasures for me of reading your book was that it gave me the chance to think about my own childhood and my own the way that I process feminism. I was born in 1960, so I'm a little bit older, but I think that, you know, we were coming at it from about the same time. Feminism, I don't remember the first issue of Ms. I grew up in far southwestern Virginia, not in an intellectual household. My parents didn't subscribe really to much except Reader's Digest, and I certainly didn't get Ms. And yet I remember being profoundly affected by feminism at an early age, and I can't even figure out why or where the forces were sort of trickling down. I remember when I was 11 in the fifth grade, at that point the school patrol was all male, and three of us decided to gender integrate the school patrol, and we agitated to be able to wear the orange crossing badge. And I remember that we were allowed to hold the doors. They let us into the school patrol. They wouldn't let us out on the street corners, but they would let us hold the doors open for the school children. And so it was a sort of a partial victory. And then I remember in junior high school in like the mid-1970s having really ardent debates with boys in my social studies class about women's lib, as it was called. And I felt actually pretty empowered by the teachers and pretty empowered. I think our parents were sort of amused by this, and they were pretty supportive. And I think it's because we had kind of hippie teachers in the 70s, and so they were supportive. I never felt silenced in classrooms. And for me, it really wasn't until I got to college in the Northeast, going to Princeton, and I remember, you know, women hadn't been there for 10 years yet, that I really felt like I ran, oh, this is the patriarchy, okay, because it was just a really much more hidebound, much more conformist social atmosphere. Women professors weren't getting tenure, and, you know, for reasons that we didn't understand. There were feminists on campus, but it was a very conservative social environment, so to sort of stick your neck out and be a feminist was not really that cool. So for me, that was when the climate changed and the world started sort of pushing back against my aspirations. But it's funny, because I look back and I try to figure out, why did I even know about feminism? And I think it was like Billie Jean King and Shirley Chisholm and these cultural influences that were sort of trickling in. And yes, I remember Charlie Perfume as well, but it was these sort of random cultural influence that really had a big impact. Similarly, I can tell you the reason that girls still want to get married is shows like Say Yes to the Dress, which my daughter religiously watches. So she's going to have a job, but she's also going to have, you know, a fabulous wedding, right, that she's already thinking about. So I just, So one of the things I wonder, I guess, because like you, I saw friends as we sort of moved through the workforce. I did see a number of my friends continued to work and to push themselves professionally, you know, and some made the decision at some point not to or have gone back and forth. Why do you think in your cohort you were one of the few that did continue sort of working and pushing yourself on all fronts?
Yeah. First of all, I really enjoy your thoughts, so thank you. You know, I'm not entirely sure, to be honest. I think part of it, and you may have experienced something similar at Princeton, I was in very male, conservative, tough places, and it was just hard for women to get by. So I think particularly at Harvard Business School, where the numbers have remained the same, it's just a tough place for women to get tenure. Interestingly, all of my friends from graduate school have stayed in the workforce and have been very successful. It was sort of my friends from college who wound up taking more traditional paths. And then the Harvard Business School women have stayed in the workforce. They just didn't make it at that particular place, which was, you know, sounds like, you know, Princeton as well. It's just tough places. But I think, you know, it's very hard to look back at your life and say, you know, why you made the choices you did. I think at some subconscious level, I was making choices that made it easier for me. I was supposed to go into the Foreign Service. That was the game plan. And actually did get in. And it turned out this is always one of those fascinating ironies of my life. I completed the security clearance, and then the Secret Service found out I was too young, which you would have thought might have been sort of a basic. Young. I had gone to college young, so I wasn't 22 yet. So I kind of bided my time until I was old enough to go in. And at that point, I had fallen in love with the man who's now my husband. And I don't remember actually consciously making the decision, but I think I did subconsciously realize that going into the Foreign Service was going to be really hard mm-hmm. if I wanted to have a marriage and
right.
a family.
Right.
And I gave up on that dream. And I didn't consider it as a sacrifice at the time. But, you know, I was all of 23 when I kind of said, you know, I'm not going to follow that path. I'm going to stay in academia. Which does turn out to be one of the mm-hmm. easier, not that it's easy, mm-hmm. but it is an easier path to have a family because you have flexibility.
Yeah, that's interesting what you said about the Foreign Service, because one of the things I reflected, I was at the Washington Post for a number of years, and one of the things that was really hard for women and remains hard for women is to be a foreign correspondent,
yeah.
is to be a foreign correspondent and have a family. So I watched any number of male colleagues who were foreign correspondents, their wife would be the trailing spouse, they would have, you know, they would go for 2 years here, 3 years here, and their children and their wife would follow, and then they would come back, and that was a path to newsroom advancement.
Right.
And it was something that just wasn't available to women. And I think, you know, I think... One of the sort of ironies of the newspaper crisis and the closure of foreign bureaus is that's become less
that's
a route to advancement
really
in newsrooms now, because it's just not it's not something that anybody
right.
is doing quite as much as they were. And I think that the Foreign Service and the CIA and places that require you, I think they're getting better about the trailing spouse thing. But living in Washington in particular, I'm sure a lot of people, you know, people who were in the Foreign Service or they were in the CIA and they have moved there. And that's always been a very hard route for women to have, not even have it all, but just have a family and a job.
And I think this is a jumping to a different question, but when people raise the question about what can corporations or organizations do to make it easier for women, these are actually the nitty-gritty kind of issues that are not talked about enough. But, you know, if foreign travel is a real problem for women, you know, maybe you need to think about different paths towards success in an organization that doesn't involve you have to spend 2 years out of the country, which, you know, for GE or IBM, that was always part of the game.
Right, right. Yeah, I interviewed a group of young engineers who actually were interviewing with an oil company that does require movement, and they actually like to have married couples, and they require these couples to decide at a pretty early age who's going to be the leading spouse and who's going to be the trailing spouse professionally, which I've always wanted to report that out, how they do that exactly, because that would be an interesting set of negotiations to
yeah.
have.
Yeah.
So your argument that women have plateaued, I mean, I'm not convinced that women have plateaued. I mean, when you look at the statistics...
Maybe not permanently, at the moment.
Yeah. Okay, but when you look at the statistics, I mean, you're in academia, you know this better than I do. Women are actually pretty close to 60% of college and university students. So in academia, at least, as undergraduates and in community colleges getting associate's degrees, women outnumber men. So women are, you know, by far a majority of valedictorians in high school. So academically, women are actually outachieving men. And it's still the case that a woman who graduates from college on average doesn't earn as much as a man with a college degree, but eventually the sheer numbers of college educated women, I think, are going to propel women. I mean, women are going to have to enter into relationships that, in fact, in which they are the better educated spouse. And it may happen in cases that therefore the couple does go forward with the woman's career, the one that is privileged. And I guess looking at the fact that, you know, you're writing this book, Sheryl Sandberg's writing this book, Anne-Marie is writing, that, you know, you have these women who are in really top positions writing, yes, about how hard it is, but the women are there. And so I guess I feel a little bit more optimistic about the plateau part.
Yeah, and I'm not pessimistic about it, but I think it's important to note that the numbers really haven't budged for 20 years. And we're way beyond the point now where you could just blame the pipeline, because women have been 50% of college students since you and I went to college. So we should have already had one or two generations of women reaching to the top. And that's where we're seeing the fallout. And I think the reasons for the fallout are much more subtle now. It's not that there's not enough women coming out of the top schools. They're there, as you say, they outnumber men. It's not that women don't want these jobs. It's not that they don't have role models, because we have had other than U.S. president, we kind of have had the first generation of pioneers across the sectors. So why are women dropping out before they reach the top? Mm-hmm. And I think this is where we get these subtle problems. They're dropping out because they've had the second kid, and it's too hard. They're dropping out because they're just feeling frustrated and crazy, and they don't need to work. You know, there's enough family income. This is, I really think, what you see a lot of in law and finance. A lot of couples where both partners are in finance, as those jobs escalate, it's 80 hours a week. There's just not enough hours in the day. Part of this, and this is something I've actually just really stumbled upon as I've been giving these talks, a lot of women in the top jobs have stay-at-home spouses.
Yep.
Their husbands stay at home, or their wives stay at home.
That's
and
right.
Nobody talks about that. Right. I did a big dinner at an investment bank last week. There were 30 women there, all incredibly accomplished. Somebody pulled me over afterwards and said, if you went around that room, every single woman has a stay-at-home spouse.
I actually read a book about that.
But not enough people. I think there's still that little taboo that women are kind of embarrassed to admit that their husbands stay home. We have to change that part of the conversation.
Right.
So I think these things are fixable. We just have to get over a lot of the subtle issues, in addition to the policy pieces, that particularly when you're talking at lower socioeconomic levels, the lack of affordable daycare is just a killer.
Right, is huge. Yeah. Yes. And I think, as you point out in your book, it's true that the plateau has occurred and persisted in industries like law and finance, but there are other fields like medicine where women really have made breakthroughs and in some cases come to dominate certain medical specialties. So structurally, there must be something about medicine that is different. And you talk about that in the book. You talk about the fact that, I mean, in finance, if a man and woman get married, it could happen that his salary is just so large that at a certain point she says, you know what, it's just not worth it for me to be working. Women are always, you know, am I making enough to pay the child care? Is it justifiable? And so if he's working 100 hours and making tons of money, then she's more likely to drop out. In medicine, that's not so likely to happen necessarily.
Right. Well, and I think that this comparison is fascinating, because I think women do stay in medicine in much higher numbers. Part of the reason, I think, is nobody goes into medicine by accident.
Right.
You know, it's set. No,
it's
true.
They
love it. You're passionate about it. You're paying an absurd amount of money for so many years. Women and men who become doctors want to be doctors. I know a lot of women who go into either business school or law school kind of because they graduated from a top college. They know they should go to graduate school, and they go to law or business school. And 10 years afterwards, if they don't really have the passion for what they're doing, and they've wound up marrying somebody who makes the kind of salary you get in those fields, it's just easier for them to opt out. And the other thing about medicine, which I think is so important and is so useful, women have also made choices about which subfields to go into. And so you're seeing a lot of women increasingly in fields like anesthesiology, emergency room medicine, where you have hours that you can control.
Right.
Interestingly, women are going out of OBGYN because that's actually the hardest one to control your hours. They're going into practices where you'll say, we'll have 10 people in the practice rather than five. We'll make less money, but we're not on call as often. I think medicine really offers a very interesting template of choices.
Right.
And they're not giving up choices, but they're choices.
Right, right. And veterinary medicine as well has
right.
become dominated
right.
by totally. Women because of part of structural changes in the field that allow you to control your hours. So the parts of your book that are personal, for example, when you write about your own struggles with anorexia in high school, was it hard for you to write about that and talk about it?
It was really hard.
Yeah.
So I talk about anorexia. I talk about this horrible breast pumping incident. A little bit, TMI, and I've never written anything along those lines. But what compelled me to write this way is the Wall Street Journal had this thing a couple of years ago where they asked college presidents to write one of their own admissions essays, which is a very clever thing. And you had to agree to write the essay before they gave you the question. The question I got was, please describe an average day and how you find solace in your routine. Which is just like a horrible question to ask anyone. And what I did, being, knowing something about the college admissions process, I turned the essay on its head. And I wrote this piece about just a horrible day I was having. And my husband was stuck in Buffalo in a snowstorm. And three kids had to go to three different places. And my son dropped his cell phone and drove over it with the car. And then the cat brought in a half-dead chipmunk. And I had to deal with this chipmunk rather than writing the speech on stem cell technology I was supposed to be writing. So I wrote this for the paper. And I got the biggest response I've ever gotten to anything I've ever written. And people would come up to me at conferences and say, you're the dead chipmunk lady, right? And I realized I had hit a chord. Mm-hmm. That by writing, and I had written this quickly and in sort of a rage, that people felt like I was describing their lives. And so it took me a while to write this book to get comfortable with the personal stories. But at least thus far, the response has been really good because I'm having a lot of women of all ages come to me and said, you were describing my life, mm-hmm. or let me tell you about my breast pump story, or my divorce. I think it's somehow, because I am, I am a successful person, being able to show some of the, the mm-hmm. dirt under the whatever, somehow validates these tough choices that we're all making.
Yeah, I think the breast pump story is becoming obligatory because
yes.
Sheryl Sandberg has a breast pump story in her book as well. So, yes.
Well, and it is, the breast pump moment is the moment, I think, at a very physical level,
yeah.
women realize that my life has just become complicated
yeah.
and painful.
Right, right. In a way that my husband's
is never going to.
In that sense, yes. Although, as you say in your book, and as we know, as we keep saying, I mean, men are feeling more work-family conflict than women are at this point. So the conversation, I think, is beginning for men as well.
Yeah.
And maybe that's going to be where some of the... if we want to get past the plateau, that's where the conversation is going to have to become. Are you getting much reaction from men? Are you?
I am. I mean, this is a largely female room. When I spoke at Politics and Prose last night, there were a lot of men in the room. I spoke at one of the investment banks last week, and the room was a third male. I think, and this is where I may be perhaps overly optimistic, I think men want to solve this problem. We're not dealing anymore with a generation of nasty men who don't want to let women in the office or want to harass
mm-hmm.
them. Still some of that. But we're dealing with men who've watched their wives struggle.
Who have daughters
who they fundamentally want to succeed.
Right.
And they're running corporations or organizations where they're problem solvers and they can't solve this problem. So I think what needs to happen is women need to allow men into the conversation. And men need to actually listen and hear some of this stuff. It's the travel. It's the breast pumping. It's the, I need 2 hours a week to go buy socks for my kids. It's figuring out how we just try and build different patterns of work. And I don't think it's impossible. I think, we're pretty close. We just got to get
right.
over a bunch of these hurdles.
Right. So then let's talk about Harvard Business School and the Jody Cantor article in the New York Times, because it sounds like there was this effort to change the culture there, which really sounds like one of the last bastions of patriarchy and just high octane, high testosterone. I trying to think of a sort of a polite word to use. I'm coming up short. But it sounds like such a pressure cooker. What your take on the, you all might have read the piece in the New York Times about how, you know, a dean charged in and decided to change things and to make sure that women were more included in the conversations at Harvard Business School and that professors were coached and assessed differently. Your take is that, in fact, there wasn't a lot of change, or I don't know.
I think they're really trying. So I think the new dean of HBS is committed. He's an Indian man, you know, so he's diverse himself in different ways. He empowered two women who I've known forever. Both are awesome. One was the first openly lesbian professor at the school. The other is a Korean mom of two. So they're all kind of the outsiders. And they're really trying to change the culture in the place. I give them a million kudos. And they're doing things that are easy to make fun of, like teaching women how to raise their hand in the classroom. But they're really powerful. Mm-hmm. Because having sat there for nearly 20 years, women don't raise their hand the right way in the classroom. They put it up tentatively. They pull it back. They sneak it up. They catch your eye. If you're the professor, you can't call on them because they're not sticking their hand up. So I think they're trying. I think, you know, the article has raised a huge ruckus. It's raised a ruckus on the outside. It's raised a ruckus on the inside. The students are mad at each other. The faculty are mad at each other right now. But I give them kudos for trying. And I give HBS kudos for allowing Jody to spend as much time as she did and really to put all the dirty laundry out there. Mm-hmm. So, I think this is actually a productive moment, mm-hmm. even though everybody's feeling kind of miserable right now.
Right. And to me, reading it with fascination, it was to me also a sign that when you do get a female president at a university, even though it was a male dean who she empowered to, Drew Gilpin Faust, right. empowered to bring about the changes, it really does matter. And it really does change the culture and the conversation. And it's not that the female students at Harvard Business School are disempowered themselves, but I guess one of the things that I've noticed in this conversation is when Sheryl Sandberg writes a book, or Anne Marie writes a book, or you write a book, and there's always this niggling, well, these are the elite women, and they're ignoring the situation of other women, you know, who aren't elite. And so every woman who writes a book has to say, I understand that I'm not writing about all women, and I'm sorry. And yet when men write books about leadership, about leading corporations or whatever, they don't say, you know, I'm sorry, I know that all men don't live this life, and I'm just talking about my life, and I'm sorry about that. They never feel like they have to say that. And yes, I mean, as a journalist, you know, we should capture everybody's life experience, and we have to be out there, we have to become more collective, you know, but actually the struggles that women have as leaders of corporations or university presidents, they matter. Because when women get in power, I truly believe when you have more women on the Armed Service Committee, then they pay more attention to sexual harassment in the military. So I feel like women are constantly made to apologize for the fact that they're writing about their experiences and they're not capturing every woman in the world's experience in their book. And I just feel like I wish that women didn't feel like they had to apologize quite so much, even as we should be writing books about everybody's right. experience. Everybody's experience doesn't have to be captured in every article and every book.
That's a great point. That's
my little rant.
Yeah. No, you're right. I hadn't quite thought of that. You know, Jack Welch doesn't write a book
right.
saying, you know, I'm not talking for the shop worker.
Right,
you know,
right,
he just doesn't
right.
have that compunction.
Yeah.
It's a great
Although
point.
Maybe he should be.
Maybe he should be, but we apologize for it
yes,
more.
Yes, yes. So I guess the last question that I'll ask is again about, okay, so we talked about Harvard Business School, and now the young women who are under your care and tutelage at Barnard. I am very interested in this generation of women and the fact that they are more educated than the men in their general cohort. And so they do have this opportunity to enter into relationships in which they're more educated and the guy is saying, you know what, this is great. I'll follow you to California. I'll privilege your job. If you want to be in the Foreign Service, I'll follow you. And yet women seem determined, or the women at Harvard Business School, to marry some guy who's right at their level or a little bit above, you know, a little bit more educated, or making, so they keep putting themselves in these situations where they are going to have these you know, these really difficult personal conversations with their husband or their partner about whose career gets put first. And so what are you seeing in this generation of young women in terms of of their ideas about partnering, aside from saying yes to the dress and wanting
right,
it.
Right. So we have the whole fetishization of the wedding that remains. And here's where, and this would be fascinating if you all start doing some of the sort of demographic work on this. The aggregate statistics don't tell you all that much, because where you're really seeing the greatest education gap between men and women is among poor populations and among populations of color.
Right.
So it's at the community college level where you're seeing way higher numbers of women. And there's another whole set of issues that I'm sorry we're not talking about right now, but you know, what's the problem of poorly educated men of color in this country? That's another. And so that actually gets confounded in the statistics. But if you look at the world where I hang out, which is the elite, you know, the elite Ivy League world, I think there you are very much seeing women, and it is still the, you know, the whether it's cultural or biological or who knows what, you know, they want to marry guys who are more or less like them. Mm-hmm. And we do still have, I think, this deeply embedded view that I want my husband to be a little bit more successful than me, or, you know, I'm not really comfortable yet being the primary breadwinner. And that's something I think we just have to kind of get over, but you don't see a lot of conversation about that. But to go back for a moment, you know, the work that I know we both did on the fertility industry, if you look at the characteristics that parents, would-be parents, look for when they're buying eggs and sperm, bizarrely, you see these same preferences. So sperm sales are really driven by both height, which is the one attribute of physicality that matters for men, and SAT scores.
Right.
Whereas for women, it's looks.
Right. So it's height too, but yeah, it's looks.
But height is much more, which makes no sense genetically.
So the thing is that the brains are going to come from the man, and that the looks are going to come from them.
Even when people are making these almost subconscious levels about how they purchase sperm and eggs, you can see these preferences built in.
Right, and people are much less fixated on the looks of the sperm donor.
Yeah, exactly. Which makes no sense, but it's just there.
Right. So let me open it up to questions now. And I think we have someone with a microphone. So I'll just let you choose who to give the microphone to.
Oh, empowered.
Quick comment. One way, I'm actually the breadwinner in my family. My husband's been doing it for 20 years. Just a comment is, if your husband is comfortable with it, you're very comfortable with it. But what I was wondering, and I haven't read the book yet, is how do you talk about raising boys and girls? Because I actually am one of four sisters. I have two brothers too. All four of us, and you know, I'm SFS 77. So I'm older than you are, and my sisters, two of my sisters are older than I am. One is younger. All four of us have worked all of our lives. There are, God knows how many kids. I think there are like 12 kids among all of us, but we've all worked, and one of the reasons, I think, is that my dad was incredibly supportive of us, and not like you're go to school and, you know, go to colleges. You can do anything you want to, and that's all I heard growing up. In fact, my joke was that, you know, it was hard to be a boy in my family. It was much more supportive in some ways to be a girl, and my mother was the same way, but that I sort of expected. But bottom line is, I think it had something to do with the way he was raised, and my husband's the same way. He's one of two boys, and I can't figure it out. His mom was a stay-at-home mom, but he's incredibly supportive of what I do, and, you know, and our whole approach. And then the last thing is, this is a lot of fun for me because I'm in a very male-dominated field. I do radio frequency stuff all day long, and this is just so much fun for me. So thank you.
Well, thank you for the story. And I think, and I haven't written about this, but it's clearly something, an area that we need to look at what's happening in the household and what role models are either just naturally occurring in the household or are emphasized. You know, I know for myself that my my husband grew up poor. He was an immigrant family. His mother worked in a sweatshop. And so there was no highfalutin talk about, you know, women should go to work. You know, his mother worked to put food on the table. And so when we got married, it was just, he never questioned the fact that I would work. Now, clearly, you know, we don't want to demand that every kid grows up in a poor immigrant household, but how do we transmit those values? And one of the nicest parts of my experience at Barnard thus far has been realizing that my biggest supporters, both sort of emotionally and financially, are the dads of my current students, because they want their girls to succeed. And they really, they support the college, they support me, because they are determined that their girls are going to make it. That's really nice.
Economists have shown that when women got property rights in the 19th century, it was because fathers wanted their daughters to have some financial empowerment in marriage. It wasn't necessarily that husbands wanted wives to have financial empowerment. It was fathers. And I've seen male colleagues who of the fathers of daughters become much more feminized, much more conscious, I feel like, as fathers.
And there was someone, I'm going to get this wrong, but there was a study that just came out like 2 weeks ago that when men have, when the wives give birth to girls, they become more empathetic.
Yep, right.
Yeah.
Right. I saw that as well.
Yeah. Wish I remembered it better, but it was something along those lines.
Hi, thank you. I graduated from Michigan Business School about 10 years ago, and I went in, I was trying to figure it out, I got in, I was around 26, and so I was pretty average at that point. But one of the big pushes at Michigan, and I know other top business schools, was to push that age down for women, because what they were seeing is women were dropping out of the workforce because they went to business school, and then they got pregnant, and then that was it,
right,
so to speak.
Right.
So I'm wondering, I always had very mixed feelings about that because of women raising their hands in the classroom and things like that. And part of the reason I felt like myself and a lot of my female cohort did as well as they did was because they had been in the workforce. So I'm just wondering what your perspective is on that. They were used to being surrounded by men, I guess, so to speak.
Right.
And then a totally separate question. I have a couple of friends who are now in their late 30s, early 40s, having babies on their own. Like, they've kind of given up on men.
Right.
At least for the time being,
right.
And are having babies on their own. And I'm just wondering if you saw any research, like if you thought about that when you were writing your book. So yeah. Totally
and
separate questions.
Could I just ask you to clarify, did you say at the University of Michigan Business School they want women to be younger now? Right. When
so
they start?
When I graduated 10 years ago, 2003, there's a Forte Foundation that looks at women in business schools across the country. And they're talking about, and they have, I believe, done it, started to encourage women to apply earlier, at a younger age, because what they were seeing is when they were graduating from business school, they were going right into family life, so to speak, and not returning to the workforce or at a higher rate. So one of the solutions that they were considering was moving the entrance age down.
That's interesting.
Yeah. And I think
it's not just Michigan.
No, it's not just Michigan, and it's confounded a little bit by, I don't know if this was true at Michigan, but I know it's true elsewhere, the internet economy, which was also occurring at that time, that once students or kids had started working in the internet companies, they wouldn't come back to business school. So there was a concern to grab, I think, both populations younger. But I think, this issue of women, going to business school, getting married, and then never coming back to the workforce, is a real one. And I think it's part of the whole broader conversation of how can we validate these women's choice to go to business school, and then, make sure that they have some kind of support or other options, or, that can deal with all of these broader issues that we've been talking about. But it's particularly pronounced in business schools, because if you marry a guy from business school and you get the dual incomes in these very high-pressured careers, it's a problem. And I think this is also, it's a very personal issue, but the question of when to have babies and how to have babies is part of the conversation. And I would never tell people when is the right time to start a family. But when young women come to me and ask, I do say, don't put it off just because you think you should put it off to get your career under control. I think a lot of the reason that women are becoming single mothers by choice is they built their careers, they may have said no to other relationships, they may have focused on their professional lives, and it's the old cartoon, oops, I forgot to have a kid. And it's hard, and I give these women great credit. I know lots of people who are single moms by choice, whether through fertility treatments or adoption, but it's hard. It is hard, and I think they feel the double whammy of being mothers without a partner, particularly if they've built their careers, they've moved away from their families, they don't have their own mothers nearby. And I've actually seen a lot of single moms by choice actually then moving back to their hometowns because, you do need more than one person to raise a child.
Uh, Thank you. A fascinating discussion. It's relevant to my question to say that I was in the Foreign Service, and I was posted to Norway at the time that Gro Harlem Brundtland was the prime minister. And when talking about a leadership style, you got a absolute profile of what women leadership style meant when you were in Norway. 50% of the parliament was female. But I wanted to ask a broader sort of cultural question. I'm not sure Gro Harlem Brundtland worked a 60-hour week.
Yeah.
I mean, you
yeah.
have a culture in America of workaholism, which simply does not exist in Europe. And it's not only the 6 weeks August vacation, but it's also how long you work during the week. So for women, they could have quite high-level jobs in Norway and still get home and go out on the cross-country ski tracks with their kids after school.
Nice.
yeah. And maternity leave for men too.
Yeah.
For
yeah.
a year.
The work-family conversations always come down to Scandinavia.
To Scandinavia.
That's right.
Yeah.
And I think like one of the challenges at the New America Foundation is to find an American solution to this problem, because we're never going to be Scandinavian.
Right.
We're never. I mean, we can take cues from the Scandinavian countries.
But you know,
we're going to have to find an American solution.
There's a paper, the authors just sent it to me, so I don't think it's out published it yet. It's an economics paper by three Norwegian economists. And it's a really good paper, because their closing argument is the reason why Norway is succeeding along these lines is exactly what you said. They don't work as many hours as Americans do. And they said that's the single most important factor in terms of trying to achieve some kind of work-life balance. Having said that, though, what they also found was that the pay gap between men and women in Norway has shrunk to almost nothing. But there is still a premium that men get when they become fathers, statistically speaking, and a loss that women experience when they become mothers. So having children for women, even in Norway, means that they're going to make less money, whereas for men, they make more money. So even in Norway, they're not quite there. But the focus on the number of hours worked, I wish I had read that paper and heard you before I wrote my book, because I think that's another piece that it's absolutely critical.
Thanks. I just wanted to call your attention to something that really lays out the structural. The plateau is in governance, in women in government. And all you have to do is, I think, Google Representation 2020. It's a 3-minute video. Have you seen it?
Yeah.
And it's really the conclusion. It just lays out, I think, that, you know, 20% in the Senate, 10% in governors, that if we if women continue at this rate, parity won't come for 500 years.
Right.
It's pretty stunning.
Yeah.
Thanks.
And that, I think, is particularly important. I was very lucky yesterday. I got to see Senator Claire McCaskill briefly on Morning Joe, and then Senator Gillibrand in the afternoon in her offices. I'm like, I've met 10% of all the women in the Senate in one day. But what Senator Gillibrand, who I think is terrific, I think they're both terrific, was saying is that, you know, the women of the Senate really work together. They work across party lines. They're less ideological. I want to try and do a study on this. People have done this, just sort of pull it together. Because I think getting more women in these positions of government is not just important because we want more women. I think we would get a different kind of governance, which we kind of desperately need.
And more bipartisan, right now.
Yeah.
You're suggesting.
Yeah.
Whether or not that would stay if we had 50%, it may be because it's a small believer
right.
group, but that it is
it's
interesting
worth
that
trying.
There's more, it's
yeah.
absolutely worth trying just to see
right.
what it would look like.
Thank you. I'm a women's rights activist, which after hearing you talk strikes me now as a rather retro career. The feminism problem is really, it's multi-headed, but it's got two sides, the macro and the micro. And your book and Sheryl Sandberg's book and this conversation pretty much seems to be about micro. What can we women do? How can we change our attitudes if we identify less as housekeepers, homemakers, and child rearers and let that go, these individual choices, we can be more successful, have more social status, have more political power. in the Harvard Business School incident, they noticed that the women, there was a grade gap, a gender grade gap, and so that prompted their changes structurally to how they graded, to how they trained the students how to raise their hands, to how they wanted the professors to assess the students' progress and
performance.
So they did infrastructural changes. So yes, we can talk about the changes that women can make in their own lives, the value we place on certain things, how much we identify, but it seems to me kind of disingenuous to leave out of the discussion this cultural paradigm shift we have to make, which has to happen in our institutions and systemically. So unless we also have the other side of the conversation, which to my mind is paid sick days, paid family medical leave, a national early education childcare program so it's affordable and available. And that's not a lower class or lower income problem. It is a middle class and an upper middle class problem, the childcare cost. Until we talk about the macro side of it, women can try harder and raise their hands more boldly and be incredibly polished in their performance, but until we make those changes, we're still only ever going to be partially successful.
Right. And I think, you know, the good news about the conversation right now, and I hope it stays, is that we are getting a more multifaceted conversation. So I think Anne Marie's book is probably the most structural of them. Cheryl's is probably the most individual, and mine is kind of in the middle, which is always the place which is bad for book sales.
But
I think so. I mean, it's where I am, for what that's worth. You know, I think it's both. I couldn't agree more. We have massive structural problems in this country. I wish we could do more along the lines of Norway. I think it's the realist in me that says, I have less faith than I wish I had in that Congress is going to pass any of these things. So how do we begin to at least work on the other side? And to Liza's point, how do we start to get more women into the committees on Congress so that we can try and get a different model of rule formation? I also think, and that this is the pessimism, you know, maybe we give up at some of these things on the national level and we fight for state level, right, or city level or county level changes. But I think it's both. I think if you just wait for the government or the structural solutions, this is where feminism started. We've been waiting for those for 50 years. And sadly, we haven't made a lot of progress, for which I don't blame feminism. It's just, it just hasn't happened. So I think we have to work at both the micro and the macro level simultaneously, because that you need that combination to make change come about. And just to use the HBS example for a moment, I think the reason they started putting these structural solutions in place was because it was two women who had survived the place who said, you know, there's actually a problem with women raising their hands, because that's not something that I think the guys at the top would have thought about as a problem. They just thought, oh, the women aren't as good. And so I think you actually need these micro voices from the grassroots, if you will, to say this is actually a problem that we can address structurally. And that's what I'm hoping corporations and organizations will do more of. They've gotten to the point of saying, we want women, we want diversity. It's now more, I think, at the micro level saying, okay, what actually happened to that woman who you let go on Wednesday? Let's, you know, let's look at why she was let go. Let's look at why she felt like she couldn't stay. And then think about whether there's a structural solution to what looks like an individual problem. And one last thing I will say, somebody once made the comment at one of my talks that we don't use the word suffragette anymore. So just because we may change the words, but I think the cause remains.
Yeah. I have a question. Hi, just a comment and a question. First, a comment. In talking about your book, you said sharing the dirt. I would call it sharing humanity.
Thank you. Yeah.
Better.
Yeah.
And the other question, at least the way politics and finance have traditionally operated in society, they're kind of killer sports. And if you argue that different leadership styles may be a little bit different personality, is it possible women aren't attracted as much to killer sports?
Yeah. Yeah, no, I think that's right. And I think, you know, this was the kind of stuff that, you know, Larry Summers can't say, but I think should at least be put out there. You know, if finance or certain parts of finance are eat what you kill, and very competitive and very greedy and about maximizing everything, if fewer women are attracted to that, that's okay.
And I think what we're seeing sort of in finance, which is an area I know something about, women are going managing more university endowments, which is high-level finance, but for a social purpose. They're managing sort of the social responsibility funds. So they're keeping very much a foot in finance, but perhaps operating in a different way, not making quite as much money, and that's okay.
So we have one more question?
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Christine. I work for Deloitte Denmark, and I've just moved to DC, so I found it very interesting that you mentioned the Norwegian example. Denmark is quite similar to Norway, and I thought it was important to pop in here, because in Deloitte Denmark, we don't shy away for 60-hour weeks, work weeks either. And it's we have the same career problems, women going to the manager level and then leaving the company for working in a different company or in public, or in the public sector. But what has been quite interesting and what happened lately is that the government passed a law saying that women have to be represented on the boards in companies, and that there in all private companies have to be policies for empowering women to get through to have a career. And of course that has been debated a lot. The law doesn't formulate a specific number for how many women there should be on board, but it says that it has to be at least a balance between the underrepresented sex and the majority. So it has to be at least, I think it, when it, you are at 43% or something, you stop being underrepresented, technically. Yeah. So that is being implemented right now. And I was just wondering whether you have been looking at those examples and if you have been discussing here in the US how legislation and corporate governance could improve things?
Yes, and I think that the U.S. is very much looking at the European examples. A number of countries have put these systems in place. My own view on it, for what it's worth, is that I think those are solutions that would have a very tough time getting traction in the U.S. You know, we're less comfortable with quotas. We're certainly less comfortable with any kind of government mandate about what private firms should do, for better or worse. I don't see those happening. Although I think we should learn from the European example and see how they play out. What's also happening in this country, which is compounding it, particularly in the finance sector, is, for all good reasons, there's a big spotlight right now on the boards of these financial services company, and it's actually making it harder for people who don't have years and years and years of very specific financial expertise to be put on these boards, because they get attacked by the shareholders. Mm-hmm. And because there are so few women who have years and years of financial industry expertise, here's where the pipeline actually is pretty slim. So I think the chances of getting something like that implemented in this country right now are very, very slim, but it's going to be really interesting to see what happens in Scandinavia, and the UK is also moving towards that.
So thank you so much, Deborah, for fitting us into your schedule. Thank you, everybody, for coming. A great conversation, great questions. Thank you so much for making time out of your mornings to come join this conversation. And